Well, good afternoon and welcome everybody to yet another edition of the new old show here on 91.3 KSVY FM Sonoma. I am your host, James Marshall Berry, and I'm fiddling with the mic here because now that they've put foam covers on them, and I don't know, I'm not hearing the sweet spot. See, now there's the sweet spot I want to hear, but I don't want to be too close because they've got all the stuff is new, so we're still feeling our way out with this all this new gear in here. But we are live. We are back live in the studio today, and we have a once again, you know, when I do the show, a lot of times there are people I know and people I've known for years, and so I have to act like I don't know them and ask questions I already know the answer to. But when I get guests that I don't know, it's kind of my favorite thing to do because I get to ask questions and truly that I don't know the answers to. And so today we have live here in the studio with us Desirae Garcia, I believe. Hi. Hi, how are you?
Good.
And she is a new musician here in Sonoma. I wasn't sure what you answered one of the questions by just saying that you had moved here and you're working. I didn't know if you were just passing, you know, Kat sent me the thing and said, hey, we're doing the show. And I thought maybe she's just passing through. Maybe she's a traveling Wilbury and then just rolling right through. But you live here in Sonoma now.
Yeah.
So you've landed here.
Landed here. Four and a half months ago.
And you came here from Maui?
Yeah, came from Maui.
What part of Maui were you in?
Most recently. Me and my family are West Maui. In Napili.
Great. I would be there now if it wasn't for some other circumstances. We usually go a couple times a year, but we started going to Kauai.
Oh, nice!
But the beaches of Kaanapali I love. The town of Paia, I love.
Maui no Kauai, it's real. Maui's the best. It's
magic. Yeah. And you know, I mean, Lahaina will never, you know, I mean, we had fires 7 years ago here, and they burned down 8,000 homes, and there are still people who are trying to rebuild, and it's been 7 years.
Yeah.
And so hopefully, you know, with the things that people have learned, things get back up to speed, in Maui quicker. I mean, when this all happened, I was donating money to random families, and it felt good to be able to help.
Yeah,
but it's a feeling. I mean, I had people here that literally drove through fire to save their lives, and it was pretty traumatic. And so, you know, you want to help. It was just, you know, and being over there and thinking, how on earth could that have even happened? You know, but then again, even here it was like, well, how did it happen here? They burned concrete Kmarts, you know, down. So that was the same thing. But anyway, that's not why we're here to talk about.
I mean, it's why I'm here.
Is that kind of how you ended up here? Was it because of the fires?
Me and my family, you know, we worked in Lahaina. We were going to raise our baby in Lahaina, basically. But yeah, we just moved up to Napili we lived on Mahinahina, which was like a great little street to live on, which is in, you know, what they call it, Mahinahina, the neighborhood, but it's just like right, it's like just north of Lahaina, basically.
Okay, so in between Kaanapali and the,
right
where the Longs is before you got up there to the, right where the bypass comes back in.
all that. Yeah, we were a West Side little family, but I'd been there for about 5 years, and my husband, who I met on Maui, had been there a little bit longer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but we were, after the fire, we're like, okay, we should figure out what our next move is, and he was raised here in Sonoma, so we came back here.
Oh, he was raised in Sonoma?
Yeah.
Oh, so he's, how long was he over there for?
Like 6 years, but he also kind of traveled around a little bit. He's a glass blower, so he was in Seattle a little bit and for Portland for a little while. And
I wonder, you know, there's a handful of glass blowers here. I imagine they all know each other. So I'm wondering if
it seems like they kind of all know each other.
I wonder if I met him or something at some point in time.
Yeah.
Were you performing in Maui?
I played a little bit of music on Maui. I was kind of joking that when I moved to Maui, I was like gonna quit music, basically. Like, I brought my, you know, guitar and my bass and my little recording demos gear, just because I knew that, like, music always happens, like, you know, when you're when you're trying to get away from it, or when you're trying to transition in life, or when transition is happening to you, that's when like the music comes. And so I brought the things to make demos, but I was like, I'm not going to play shows. I'm not going to pursue it. I'm going to kind of just quit music. And that's like when this new album that I have recently put out called Lengthy Sunny Spells, like the whole album came at that point. And I was like, okay, well, I guess music doesn't quit you. No. You know, you just keep going.
It never does.
No, it doesn't.
We're live in the studio with Desirae Garcia, who we're learning a lot about. Now, when did you, how long have you been playing guitar? And was guitar your first instrument?
You know, I guess yes and no. Yes, yeah. Because for like, I think it was like my 13th birthday or something, my parents bought me a classical guitar and they hooked me up with a classical guitar teacher, but I probably took like 2 lessons.
Right.
Maybe 4.
I realized that I'm like never going to learn any of this stuff.
Yeah, it just it didn't stick, you know? So I had the guitar forever. Like I literally had it until I was, you know, moving out at 18.
Right.
And then after that, I didn't really pick up the guitar again until I was playing music with Ainea Lujan, which was for a band called The Haunted Wind Chimes, and he was doing all of the playing and we were kind of co-writing songs together, and then I started learning how to play the guitar better again and like figured out, you know, I needed to play the guitar if I'm going to be a songwriter, and was writing a lot, and so it just made sense to marry the two, and never really played very well. And then I got a baritone ukulele on Oahu when we were visiting my parents who were on Oahu at the time. And that is tuned DGBE for all you guitar people, which is, you know, the high 4 strings of the guitar. Mm-hmm. So basically, like, took out 2 strings and made, like, super simplified, like, what I was learning on guitar at the time. And I played the baritone uke in that folk band for a decade almost.
Wow.
And, yeah, it really made songwriting more accessible too. Like I feel like I found my voice because of the simplicity of the instrument and really fell in love with that instrument. So after that, switched to bass, which is the low 4 strings of the guitar.
Right.
And after learning both of those things, I feel like that's when like playing really kind of like became easier for me. I've never really been a guitar player. I'm more of a songwriter, you know, more of a storyteller, I guess.
An instrument player.
Yeah.
Well, now, when you were young, did were you surrounded by music? Were your parents musicians at all?
They weren't musicians, but they have always, you know, our families always loved music and listened to music. You don't clean the house without music on, one of those things.
Right.
And my siblings were always in choir or, you know, all of that. So.
Yeah. I mean, when you move, the first thing that gets plugged, well, first, it was a stereo. Then the first thing that gets plugged in was the stereo.
Yeah.
And it was the last thing to leave the house. So
it's true. You need music for everything.
I do. My wife does not. Music is in the background to her. She could live do without it. And I just like, how do you? I can't be in a place that's completely silent.
Yeah, when the music's not on, you're left
makes
with
me. It makes me batty. Yeah. It's like there has to be. Yeah. Music has to be going.
I agree.
So, when you were young. So you never really had that moment where you decided, you know, you kind of just ended up being a musician. You never had that moment where you saw somebody or went to see a show and thought, wow, this is great. I need to do that. There was never really that epiphany. Who were you into when you were younger? What type of artist and what type of music?
I mean, I always like to say that in my family, we kind of grew up on like classic pop music, you know, like Michael Jackson and like, you know, the great, like just the great radio songwriters, if that makes sense.
Right.
And so we grew up on, you know, lots of like Michael Jackson, Madonna, Mariah Carey, like all of these like
from the 80s,
iconic,
from the 80s,
basically. Like epic. Yeah.
Right.
And so I don't know. I feel like pop music. Songwriting was always like fully integrated into my subconscious. And then as I got older, you know, in high school, was listening to more of like the Velvet Underground and like the Pixies and stuff like that. And that songwriting is like, even though it's not like radio pop music, it's still like structured, like pop music, if you will. I mean, okay, the Velvet Underground maybe a little bit less. They get a little bit.
You know, I mean, well, Lou Reed and the Velvet Underground, I mean, they wouldn't be pop songs per se, but they definitely had a thing going, you know.
Yeah.
And you knew when it was the Velvet Underground.
Yeah.
And
it's true.
So is mainly pop stuff from the 80s. You never delved back into the 60s other than Velvet Underground,
well, you know,
which is '60s.
Growing up, I feel like it was all like you know, music you could like reach without really digging, like growing up. And then which was like, I don't know, really great. And then as I got older, it turned into like I guess like a little bit more rowdy or a little more obscure. And then, you know, later yet, then it's like, oh, I'm obsessed with Paul McCartney, who does write like perfect pop songs. And you can hear him try to stray away from like pop formats and be like, I can write like this, you know, but like he writes these like perfectly structured, you know.
It's interesting to hear you say that pop music, you know, is like the Beatles. I mean, I grew up.
Yeah.
People your age, I'm assuming you're considerably younger than me. But, you know, to them, pop means something different. To me,
yeah.
A pop song is, you know, verse, chorus, maybe bridge, verse, chorus. And it's done. And it's 3 minutes, 20 seconds long.
Mm-hmm.
And,
but
know,
that's
sweet.
Almost every Beatles song.
Yeah. Yeah.
What
but
you just
like
said.
The sweet and, you know, and, I mean, I tell the story of how I only owned one Beatles 45,
mm-hmm.
and it was The Long and Winding Road, and I traded it to the kid across the street for Venus by The Shocking Blue, because I was fully into pop, you know, that was way more in my style, because I liked pop songs. So it's interesting to hear you describe pop music as, you know, as what I think it is, where, you know, where pop, you know, stands for popular music, especially in the 80s and 90s,
mm-hmm.
that's when,
mm-hmm.
you know, you know, I guess it was pop music going on in the 80s, but I was playing in a metal band. So a lot of those songs that were considered pop that got millions, that sold millions of records, even to this day, I'm like, no, now who's this?
Yeah.
Because it wasn't on my radar then.
Yeah.
Because those weren't pop to me, you know. And ironically, a lot of the hair bands and the metal bands, they kind of took over, in my mind, the pop music thing, you know. I mean, you listen to a Poison song and it's verse, chorus, guitar solo, verse, chorus, and with lots of vocals, and they sang about girls and cars and cutting
it's
a school.
Perfectly
and
structured pop.
Yeah. That was what they did, and that's why I think I, you know, gravitated to that whole world, and then grunge came along and ruined everything I was good at. So I was mad at rock music for 10 years. I went and played in a Southern rock act and toured around with that, but we still do that. But it's interesting to hear you say the pop like that. Now, have you ever you play acoustic primarily?
Mm-hmm,
Do you own electric guitars? Have you ever played electric guitar? I mean, sure, you've played an electric guitar.
Yeah,
but
I have. I have one. It's kind of a Mustang that my friend built.
Uh-huh.
And so I own that, and I love it because I was like, oh, it's got like a little whammy bar, so I can do like some syrupy little like, you know, at the end of the song, because
I'm not a little Chris Isaac.
I'm just not like a super proficient, you know, I don't solo a bunch, so I never thought I needed an electric guitar really, you know, but I do love like a little whale sound or two, you know, and then I have a Epiphone Dot, which is, you know, technically an electric guitar, but it's like semi-hollow.
Right.
And that's great. That's cool for like if you're playing with a band, you know, and you don't want as much feedback. But like, I'm not really an electric guitar player, so it's still got acoustic vibes, you know.
Yeah, we're here live in the studio with Desirae Garcia, finding out a little bit more about her. Now, have you ever played in a band with the electric guitar? Or is it mainly just fooling around just with your own singer-songwriter?
I played for a minute in a all-women shoegaze project called The Spirits in Colorado Springs.
Colorado Springs.
It was very brief, and I didn't play guitar.
You would be surprised how many people making their way out here ended up in Colorado or Colorado Springs before they went to L.A. or went to somewhere else and then somehow ended up here.
Yeah.
The amount of musicians that are here in Sonoma Valley, I mean, you've only been here 4 months. It's astonishing.
Yeah.
I grew up only 30 minutes away, and there are more musicians here in Sonoma Valley than I think in all of Marin County added up. It's really the amount of musical talent here is mind-boggling. Yet we have nowhere really – I mean, we have two or three places that are considered music venues.
I was wondering. It's really interesting to hear you say.
It's a lot of it is just move that table over there and just unplug the microwave and plug in over there. And it's like, wait, what? So it's, you know, it's nice to see the Sebastiani Theater doing live music now. That's never happened in the 30 years I've lived here. I mean, there was always movies, and Roger's got some guys in there now running it that are putting on shows. The only problem about with that is, you know, it's you almost, you know, you could have 120 people come and see you. Mm-hmm. And in that theater, it's like, oh, it's still half empty. So, yeah. It's kind of a weird vibe.
It's a big space.
It is a big space.
It's a beautiful space.
Yeah. Well, and now the community center, it's been on and off. I mean, I played in Andrews Hall more than once.
Yeah.
But it was 10, 15 years ago when you could still have a rock band till 10 o'clock at night. You could rent a place out and have a dance or whatever. And, that's, you know, now they've got the new stage and everything else. And that brings us to where you're playing there this weekend.
Yeah.
And that's kind of why we're here today. Well, not all why, but kind of why.
Yeah.
And is this part of a series? I know Vanessa is now the executive director. And, of course, her husband, Rand, with Music Nomad, a big proponent of local music and music you know, music things, all things music. Mm-hmm. Is this something, is this a new series or?
You know, I couldn't even tell you. I just know I've been doing ceramics at the community center since I got here. Basically, it's the first place my husband took me when we moved here because he was like, you're going to love this place. It's going to make you feel like you're right at home. And he was right. And, you know, have been hanging out there a lot. And then when I posted that I was re-releasing, because I technically releasing, but I technically released this album like a year and a half ago and then took it off of all streaming platforms and like re-released it under a small new record label. So when I re-released it, Kat in the office, who also works here for the radio show, has a radio show in the mornings, and she was like, I've listened to your record and we like it in the office. Do you want to play this concert? And so I don't know if it's part of a series or not, but they just offered me this, you know, the hall and this opportunity. And I was super excited about it because I just moved here and would love to share music, play music. And
well, that's great. I can't wait to hear more. We're going to take a quick break here. We are at the 20s. You're listening to 91.3 KSVY-FM Sonoma. I am your host, James Marshall Berry. We are here live in the studio with Desirae Garcia. We're going to be back to hear her and hear more from her in just a minute. But in the meantime, we're going to hear a word from our sponsors. Of course, we are community radio here at 91.3. We are supported only by volunteers. And all of our hosts are volunteers. We do not have big checks coming in. The Coca-Cola Foundation has not discovered us yet, although we'd be happy if they would, but they have not. So our operating expenses funded entirely by people like you, the listeners, and our sponsors. So if you feel like you like the things that you hear here, point your browser to ksvy.org, and there are places there where you can, you know, that was great. I'm just going to donate $20. Or you think, you know what? I'm gonna not have three lattes a month, and I'm gonna donate $20 a month. I'll just hold off having these three lattes. Actually, it's gonna be more than now. I guess lattes are $7. I don't even know. It's on the list of things I don't get to do anymore. But if there's three of them, you know, so maybe you want to donate monthly. We would love that. We'd appreciate that too. So point your browser to ksvy.org. And if you are, maybe you're listening on the computer now. If you're not, and you're driving around, you're thinking, God, I got to get out of my car. I can't listen to the rest of the show. Well, this show particularly, we're going to podcast it after this, but there's our app. You can go to the App Store or the Google Play and you can download the KSVY app and you can listen to us all over the world. Well, I don't know if you can listen to us in Russia. They're letting you do a lot of things over there, but technically it could happen. But anyway, we are going to hear from some of our sponsors. Maybe you'd like to be a sponsor. There's more information there. And if you do nothing else when you're at the website, sign up for the newsletter, and we'll make you sure we keep you informed of new shows. It has the list of all the civic meetings that Sonoma TV is shooting for the month. We shoot the city council. We shoot the planning commission. I should use a better word. We film the city council. We film the planning commission. We film the MAC. We film all of these public meetings so that we can keep track of our public officials and what they're up to. And if you can't make the meeting or it's an inopportune time, they're all on our YouTube channel as well. So we're doing our best we can to provide you with information and education about Sonoma Valley. And we would love it if you would join us by pointing your browser to ksvy.org. Well, thank you, Jeff Gilbert, Wow. I could use some restraining orders and judgments and all those sorts of things. I may have to call the law company. You think I'd have been paying attention, but no, I clearly was not. I am your host, James Marshall Berry. This is the new old show. And you may wonder, why is it the new old show? Well, 20 years ago when we started the station, this is our 20th year. We're having our 20th year celebration. And that's why I said, if you subscribe to our newsletter, you get all the events that we're planning on having. If you point your browser to ksby.org. But this is our 20th anniversary. And back in the day, I used to just play local music CDs and we'd have a local musician in for 15 or 20 minutes. So now we're doing an entire hour and we're into our second season of this version of the show. So it's the old show, but it's the new version. So it's the new old show. And that's how this all worked out. So
kind of into it.
We are live here in the studio with Desirae Garcia, and we're going to get right to a song here in just a little bit. She is playing this Friday night, mm-hmm. And she is headlining because she has an opener. Tell me a little bit about there's tickets still available? People can get tickets at the door?
Yeah, you can get tickets at the door, or you can go online at Sonoma Community Center and get tickets there ahead of time.
Right. And the show is, doors are 6:30, show is 7.
Mm-hmm. And they'll have, you can go and get drinks and snacks if you want.
There'll be wine, I'm sure, because that's what we do.
Yeah.
There's an opener now. Do you know anything about the person opening for you?
Ryan Ballard. I checked out his music, and it is a of the kindred kind of, you know, Americana vibe, which is really lovely. Also a songwriter, storyteller. Mm-hmm. So I'm excited to hear him live. We have not met yet, so I'm excited.
Well, how did he end up on the bill? Who booked this show?
In the office, kind of match made us. She kind of put the whole thing together. She was like, you know, do you want to play a concert in Andrews Hall? And I said, of course. And she's like, this will be fun. We'll get Brian Ballard, who, you know, like I said, I've been doing ceramics at the
center. Ceramics and guitar. I mean, you know, you get the stuff underneath your.
Yeah, you can't have fingernails for either, so they're great.
No, that's true. I'm wondering how practice is going to go tonight with me.
Yeah.
But so you've never met your opener. That's
so
interesting.
Apparently he is the husband of another fellow ceramicist at the center, which is kind of like, you know, how she knows of us both.
Brian Ballard is his name?
Yep. So she kind of match made us and was like, let's put you guys together. And the music is really kindred too, so it ended up being kind of perfect.
And your set, then you're probably going to go on probably closer to 8 then, right?
Yeah, a little bit. So he'll play from like 7:30 to 8. We'll take a small break. And then I have put together a little trio, which I'm excited about.
A trio?
About.
So is it a local, with local people?
My upright bass player for the show, her name's Aviva LaFay, and she's living in Sebastopol currently, but she is a touring, you know, musician. She's a songwriter also, but, you know, plays upright bass, which is
nice.
Awesome. And then the guitar player that I have playing with us, his name is Jason Lucero, and he's currently still living on West Maui. He played on the album. Uh-huh. So I thought it would be really cool to, I asked him on a whim, you know, what are you doing on March 8th? Do you want to maybe come to Sonoma? And he's from the Bay Area originally. He's been on Maui for, I think, 7 or 8 years or something like that. So he was like, I actually could use a break. I'm going to come out and play the show.
That is amazing.
Have him. Yeah.
That is great. So even if you have something doing or you're having a little bit of late dinner, you can still catch the show by walking up and getting a ticket even at 8 or so, and you'll catch all of Desirae. Let's go to get to a tune. What do you feel like playing?
I would love to play, there's this one song that I always start every set with. It's called Give, and it's on the new record, Lengthy Sunny Spells.
Okay.
But it's probably the oldest out of all the tunes, which is why I love to start with it, because I could play it in my sleep. So if you're nervous, it doesn't matter.
It's like opening with Feeling All Right or something.
Yeah, exactly.
It's all going to work out. Desirae Garcia, live here in the studio on 91.3 KSVY-FM.
All right. Should I just go for it?
You can.
Go for it. Heart, Honey, that's the way it always starts. Giving you all that I've got. Feeding you nourishment I should be saving. I'm gonna give until you offer. I'm gonna give till there's nothing left at all. I'm gonna give until you offer. I'm gonna give till there's nothing left at all. And you tell me that you're weak. Honey, I'm gonna hold you, put your weight on me. You're stronger than you lead. Now I'm underneath you, giving you everything. I'm gonna give until you offer. I'm gonna give till there's nothing left at all. I'm gonna give until you offer. I'm gonna give till there's nothing left at all. And you dress like me. And you talk like me. And you tell me what you need. And I believe you. Honey, that's the way it always starts.
And that was Give from Desirae Garcia. Now, you say that was one of your older songs you've written. So how long ago did you write that song?
I would guess I wrote that song maybe early 2019 mm-hmm. or late 2018.
So most of this newest album, and the name of the album again?
Lengthy Sunny Spells.
And people can get that at the show if they want a physical copy.
Are you back on 12-inch records.
And vinyl also.
Yeah.
Look at you go. And the also on the streaming services, I guess, you can download it because we give away music for free now. That's because mm-hmm. that's the way that works.
You can get it anywhere.
Yeah. And so how long did it take you – that album that you had said you were going to quit playing music. So basically mm-hmm. since 2019 till what you said you released in the mid last year, 2022. So it was 2 years in the making for the album?
Kind of, yeah. I mean, that song Give was one that it was kind of homeless for a little while. I was playing it in that band Spirits I was telling you about, the mm-hmm. girl band, the shoegaze band, which I didn't play guitar, and I want to backtrack and say I played bass in it, which was important because the guitar players were guitar players. But yes, I played it with them for a minute, and then it kind of was one of those like rollover songs that like it was kind of homeless, and I loved it so much. It just it's significant to me, and I love like to sing it. It feels good to sing it, and so I just kind of kept that one with me. Like, okay, this is like important. This will go somewhere someday. Who knows when? And then when I got to Maui, basically, I maybe wrote like 6 songs when I got there that were kind of like, I like these, but they weren't like, I was just writing songs, you know? And maybe about a year later is when, actually probably like during the shutdown, like during COVID, was when mm-hmm. I started writing songs that like it felt like it was really obvious to me that I was making an album, you know? Like those, like these songs that are happening now, like these are, like these go together. They're like significant. They're a group. They like want to belong together and they want to be shared, maybe, you know?
Right. So now, have you done other albums before this one?
I have. Like I said, I played in the I played in a folk band for
over a decade, they had albums.
And we had a lot of albums, but I did put out a couple of solo albums while I was in that band, mm-hmm. kind of overlapping. And the first one is just an EP, which I do have some 7-inch records left, and I really like those. Mm-hmm. I recorded 4 songs to a 4-track tape, Tascam tape recorder. And that, I didn't have any, you know, I just was doing that for fun, like for me, and I wasn't planning on sharing that at all. And I was kind of coaxed into making a 7-inch record on Blank Tape Records, which was kind of like a cooperative effort in the community.
So you just used the rough tracks from the 4-track, not mixed or mastered or anything?
We just mastered them, you know, bounced them all, mastered them like on the Tascam, you know, sure they were all like mixed on the Tascam on the way out.
Right.
And then mastered them for vinyl and pressed them on 7-inch record. And it's definitely very lo-fi and like kitschy lo-fi vibes.
And that's the
indie
EP,
yeah. And then I put out a longer EP, I would say, because it's not quite a full length of maybe 8 songs, called Dying to Break Your Heart, a couple years after that. So maybe like, I think it was like 2013, Ill-Fitting is the 7-inch. Uh-huh. And then maybe it was 2017, 2016, I did Dying to Break Your Heart, which is like 8 songs, which I at first didn't really ever listen to, or like it was, you know how it's, when you're a musician, sometimes you're like, I can't listen to myself. That's weird. I don't enjoy this.
Hearing myself sing is the most horrifying thing
I've ever. It's just not something,
No, I don't listen to practice tapes. Yeah. I listen to none of it. And other musicians that do don't understand why I don't. But I can't take hearing my voice.
I don't know. I recommend going backwards, like giving it time and then listening to things that are older. Because one, either it'll make you laugh and you're like, do you remember that? Or like for me, for Dying to Break Your Heart, I listened to the record and I was like, this is not bad. Like, I'm willing to share this record and like, you know, I really actually kind of like it now, which is kind of a good feeling. And then, of course, Lengthy Sunny Spells, which is the newest. I'm like, okay, I feel really close to this, you know.
Well, now, what was the recording process with the new album? I mean, obviously, you've been in studios and you've done albums and you've seen how the whole thing works. I mean, mm-hmm. back in you know, my day, we set up mics and lived in the studio for 2.5 days and mm-hmm. nothing moved and nobody touched anything and you recorded all the songs. And they went on to tape and all of that. Well, these days with all the tools and there's Pro Tools and people recording stuff in their house, but there's still the let's go into the studio and do this thing. So what was your recording process with the new album?
So basically, as I wrote these songs, I made demos at home and, you know, would use like a program drum and then play my own bass and like do my own backup vocals and all of that. And so I basically took into this studio called the Fuzzbox it's in Lahaina, it's in West Maui. Really, really cool space. And still during the shutdown, which is going on forever on Maui, we're shut down for like 8 months. And they were like, okay, if you come in, you can work with a sound engineer one-on-one and you can rent studio time. And I basically I would rent like Thursdays. So I would go in for like 3 hours on a Thursday night for weeks, just like go in. And that was like, I don't know, kind of what just made me feel like life was kind of
normal.
Yeah. I was going to say like, you know, just like worth doing, you know, because like everything
was a rough time for everybody.
Kind of stopped. Yeah. And so I would
go in.
We're
still coming back from it, really.
Yeah, definitely. I feel like everyone's just kind of bouncing back like this year.
And you know, and it's like, hey, when's it going to be the way it was? And it's like, you know what? It's never going to be the way it was. It's going to be the way it is now.
Yeah.
And things are different now.
Yeah, exactly. But I was working with a sound engineer named Harrison Tatik, and we just met, you know, like walked in, shook his hand. Here are some demos that I made. And then we basically like re-recorded and like elaborated on these demos. And then we would like send out for drummers. So one of the drummers, his name is Matt Teku, and he's in Venice Beach. And I knew him from like touring days before mm-hmm. Maui. And then the other drummer, her name is Emily, and she is in Colorado, and she was the drummer for the shoegaze band.
The all-female
shoegaze bands. And she's just fabulous. So I had two separate drummers. reached out to my friend Chris Lynch, who has played with Marty O'Reilly in the Old Soul
Orchestra
here in town.
Uh-huh.
He was in Santa Cruz at the time.
I keep trying to get him in here, but he's either touring or, you know,
he's busy.
Now he's got a baby and the whole nine yards. So.
Oh, Marty.
Yeah.
He's so busy. Yeah. Chris Lynch played violin on one of the songs on their album. So kind of like reached out here and there for like some people to contribute. And Jason, who lived on Maui, he would come in and like play guitar. Nice. So we kind of like, I still played bass. I still did the backup vocals. So it was still this kind of like vacuum, but then we would kind of like open a window and like let people in, which was really a cool way to like build on an album.
I can't wait to hear it. Well, we're live in the studio here with Desirae Garcia. We're going to take a quick break. We're going to hear from our sponsors. And if you hear our sponsors and you happen to go and patronize their humble establishment, just make sure you thank them. Say, hey, I heard you're sponsoring KSVY. Thank you for that. That goes a long way. We'll be right back with Desirae Garcia here on 91.3 KSVY FM. And we're back here live in the studio with Desirae Garcia. And without any further ado, I'd like to hear another tune because we are I've talked my way right to, you know, three quarters of the hour. But so what do you got for us now?
Let's do choices. Let's do The Biggest Ache.
The Biggest Ache.
The Biggest Ache.
Okay. Yeah. The Biggest Ache with Desirae Garcia, who is playing at the Community Center this Friday, and tickets are still available if you are interested in the evening, with an opener, not Rob Zombie, Bob, what's his name?
Brian Ballard.
Brian Ballard, yeah, not Rob. Rob Zombie will not be there. I will have to fact check.
Dang it. You won't? Cancel the gig, everyone.
Here we go.
All right. Get my love. Feel I'm gonna lose every good thing that I've got. It's my fault. Ooh, do it every time. Shiver and a shake. Think of all the hearts I'd break. Mine's the biggest ache. But ain't broke, I don't wanna let you know. Leaving little parts with everyone I know. Please don't dispose. What if I need those? Shiver and a shake. Think of all the hearts I'd break. Mine's the biggest ache. Hearts I'd break, mine's the biggest ache. Shiver and a shake, think of all the hearts I'd break, mine's the biggest ache.
Desirae. Desirae Garcia live here in the studio with us. And that was the biggest ache, I'm thinking. You know, your vocals have a certain inflection to them that bring familiarity to me. I'm trying to think of who it is, but I'm not cool enough to know who anybody popular now is, what their names actually are. But I like your vocals. They sound really nice. But there's a – I'm thinking, like, God, who is – and then she sound like you sound, you know, modern. So I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, but
it's awful. No, I'm kidding. It's
your
great.
Vocal, your vocals great. Are great. So where this isn't now that you've dove back into music with all you know all fours. Where else are you gigging?
So I'm kind of just getting started back, you know, mainland as they say.
Right.
I'm really excited to be back where. Like there's so much music happening all the time and so many of your friends are like on tour and they're coming through and you can share shows. And
nice.
So after this, in May, I'll be playing a couple of shows, one with Covenhoven, a friend from Denver, in San Francisco at the Lost Church.
Okay.
On like May 3rd. And then my friend John Craigie asked me to play a song at his – he does these Beatles shows. I don't know if you've ever heard of John Craigie, and he'll do – like he'll perform all the songs from one Beatles album.
What is he even named for his act or
– just John Craigie.
Oh, it's just him then.
And, yeah, he usually plays – you know, he's a songwriter, super great. If you don't know him, look him up. He's really rad. But he – more recently, I guess, like within the past few years, has been just taking like some shows every once in a while and just doing like he'll perform all of the Beatles songs from a certain record. And so he's coming May 14th and doing Rubber Soul in Novato. And
at Hot Monk?
Uh-huh.
Oh, okay.
And I'll be doing one song at that. Just nice. Everybody will come and play like a Beatles song and then he'll perform Rubber Soul.
Excellent.
So that should be really cool. So I'm kind of just like getting my feet wet and getting back into the music scene.
You know, there's
really cool.
There's a place that there's a couple places I can help you set up. There's a winery up in Glen Ellyn, Pasagio, that does acoustic stuff. Yeah. I can say up there. And I know Hot Monk Sonoma, you know, they do the acoustic stuff on the porch. They'd probably love to have you too. I'll try to hook you up after we're done with the show.
Yeah.
We're live here in the studio with Desirae Garcia. Let's hear another song because we've got to knock off in 5 minutes.
Okay.
But what else do you got for us?
I'm going to play one called I Left.
I Left?
Yeah.
Not yet, though. Not till we finish this song, right?
I'm leaving.
Fixing to go. There we go. Desirae Garcia live. Okay. Katie, 91.3 KSVYFM.
How could I be sure? all the world on my back. I said, maybe I'm coming, but not right now. I said, maybe I'm coming, but not right now. I'm no one. Now I'm young like before it, and maybe I'll find it, but not right now.
Desirae Garcia live here in the studio. That was, again, I'm leaving? No, I missed that.
I left.
I got it. I missed it by that much.
I'm on my way out. Yeah.
Once again, she is playing her CD release party this Friday at Andrews Hall at the Sonoma Community Center. Tickets are still, in fact, I got a text while the tickets are going fast. So you should pick up a ticket beforehand. And you can do that. Well, you should if you know, we aren't endorsing or promoting. You can pick up a ticket beforehand if you'd like at SonomaCommunityCenter.org, I believe, or you can pick one up at the door. Now, if people want to get a hold of you, you're out there on the socials and all that, mm-hmm, and the Book mm-hmm. of Faces and the Instagram. And are you on Bands in Town or Spotify? Or what is your name is spelled uniquely from your average Desirae.
Yeah.
So you are Desirae
Perfect.
Garcia.
Yeah.
And that's spelled the common way. So if you search for that, that first name and that last name on the Spotify or on the socials, you can find her, you can follow her. Mm-hmm. Do you have a website? I know they're so old school these days.
I don't have a website.
Okay, well, you probably don't need one.
Yeah, Instagram is like...
I'm a website developer. Nobody needs websites. Just, then they should all be free, so...
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for taking the time and spending it with me. And
thank you so
letting
much
our
for
listeners
having me.
Have a little bit more about you. And looking forward to the show this Friday.
Me too.
Yeah, it should be fun. Thank you. We will be back next week with a guest to be determined because we haven't booked one yet. So... do tune in. Thank you very much for tuning in to the new old show here on 91.3 KSVY-FM Sonoma. I have been your host, James Marshall Berry. The guys at Five are next, and I hear them out there pre-gaming in the green room and in the lobby, milling about. So I know that they're here and they have something up their sleeve. Probably not a rabbit, but do stick around. Thank you very much for tuning in. We will see you next week.